Halfway between London and Birmingham lies the small town of Bletchley, now incorporated into Milton Keynes. Bletchley Park was an old-style private manor house set in 55 acres of land. Today, Bletchley Park is a museum honouring the codebreakers who worked there in World War II. Visitors come by car, bus, train, or on foot. Once inside, Churchill is there to welcome you with his words of commendation. Another plaque explains the incredible value of what was achieved here during World War II. Together with a wonderfully apt quote from one of Shakespeare's plays.
Right, the history of Bletchley Park is very long, very varied, and does date back to, I mentioned, the Doomsday Book, 1092. I'm not going to give you a blow-by-blow account from Bletchley Park from then till now. We'd never get outside. Who were the government department? Well, if we just go back on a timeline, they started life during the First World War, 1914-18, as Room 40. A code-breaking department working through that First World War into peacetime years, still a small operational department. During those peacetime years of the 1930s, they changed their name. They became known as the Government Code and Cipher School. Any country who would encipher messages, if we could bring those messages here to Bletchley Park, then the code-breakers would start work on them. The bulk of the messages, of course, were generated by the German troops who were using the Enigma machine.
The video shows a German officer writing a message, having it coded by an Enigma machine and transmitted by radio to another German military base. The Enigma operator must first set the Enigma to the day's key. The day's key is given in a code book that is valid for 1 month. For each day of the month, the code book gives the date, the ring setting for each rotor, the order of the rotors on the shaft, the plug board jumper settings, and the starting position for each rotor. First, he unlocks the rotors by pulling the rotor locking lever forward. Then he moves the reflector wheel to the left to allow the rotors to be removed. And he lifts out all three rotors on their shaft and consults the code book to determine how to set the ring settings of each rotor. The ring settings are adjusted by pulling back a spring-loaded locking pin that allows the outer ring of each rotor to rotate. Then the outer ring is turned until the proper number appears across from the index mark. The first rotor was just set to 4. The next rotor will be set to 6. The Enigma operator is now beginning to remove the plug board jumper wires from the plug board in front of the Enigma. He must first consult the code book and look at the column that tells him which plugs to put into the numbered sockets on the front panel. For the rotors, he is ready to start typing in the original message on the keyboard. Every letter that the Enigma operator types into the Enigma causes a light bulb to go on and light up a letter on the light bulb panel. The second Enigma operator now prepares to transmit the coded message by radio to the receiving station. The Germans believed that these Enigma-coded or ciphertext message could never be decoded. So, they send them by radio telegraph Morse code to their destination. The radio operator at the message destination receives the Enigma-coded message and writes it down letter by letter. He must set his Enigma machine to exactly the same day key. When the Enigma operator has typed in all of the Enigma-coded or ciphertext letters, The original message is ready to be delivered to the German officer to whom it was addressed.
There are three types of Enigma machine in use during the war years. The basic three rotor used by the German Army and Air Force, the modified four rotor machine used by the German Navy, and the four rotor machine, which is nothing like the other two, which is used by the Abwehr. They always worked in this two hut system. So the messages would come onto site, they would be logged, they would go into hut 8, and hut 8 would deal with the code breaking process. Once the messages are broken, they come across here to hut 4, and hut 4 deals with translation and analysis. Working in hut 4 is Harry Hinsley. He is the liaison officer with Naval Intelligence, and he will make sure that everything goes through to them in London, and they have their own plotting table and their own card index, and they will make sure that they disseminate that information out to the commanders who need to know whatever is in that message. And that is roughly the system of how it works here. So in there you'll find a story about pigeons and parachutes. You will also find the story of HMS Petard in there. It explains just how difficult it was for us to break the German U-boat messages at the beginning of the war, the wolf packs that were gathering and destroying our convoys. Rationing in this country was getting worse because the supplies weren't getting through, our sailors were losing their lives, and the tonnage of shipping was climbing in numbers. And it was the capture of U-559 that enabled us to get in to breaking these shark messages, as we codenamed them here at Bletchley Park. And breaking shark was absolutely vital to saving our convoys. We put Army and Air Force together because of the way the war is being fought. Blitzkrieg is the word they're using. They're moving across the ground as fast as they can possibly go, the ground troops, being given support by artillery, by tanks, and of course air cover. And the Germans have placed a liaison officer from the German Air Force, from the Luftwaffe, with the ground troops. And they would be reporting back to their headquarters about what was happening in one particular battle area, using their Enigma machine and its settings. But the commander of the ground troops would also be using an Enigma machine with different settings, making his reports. So you've got reports of one battle area, limited use language, being enciphered on two different machines with different settings. Marry them up and you can speed up that code breaking process with a bit of luck. So that was the whole idea of it. Now, what's it like to work in one of these huts? Well, imagine your garden shed and just make it bigger. So it's not terribly warm, it's not insulated. Good thick liner on the floor. Your heating is a coke stove. If you've got a big room, you get two coke stoves. Now, coke stoves are a bit smelly and they sort of radiate heat in a small area around the fire. So in the winter months, it was chilly. And one lady told me she always had her good best winter coat and a thick grey blanket with her. In the summer months, it would be hot and stuffy today. So it's not the conditions we would expect to be working under today. And probably today we would walk out and say, that's it, I'm not working in there. But they had to get their heads down and get on with it. They were under a lot of pressure. They knew it was vital to the war effort.
24 hours a day?
24 hours a day, 7 days a week, never stopped. The shift system kept changing. Mm-hmm. Every 8 hours, the shift would change. The one lot would go home, the next lot would come in, mm-hmm. and they would all go back to their billets. The vehicles would be usually parked around the green oval there. Cars, lorries, buses, shooting brakes, and push bikes. They would cycle in 15 miles, some of them. I'd do an 8 hour shift with a 30-minute meal break, and 15 miles back. Guesses here at Bletchley Park, we would need to use something to test our guesses. He did a lot of mathematical calculations and came up with the idea of how a machine would work to do that, to test our guesses. But that's where Alan Turing's expertise finishes. He's a brilliant mathematician, a very clever man, somewhat eccentric to say the least, and so he's told to go to Letchworth, the British Tabulating Machine Company, speak to Doc Keane, who is the leader of research and development there, and he will convert Alan's mathematical calculations into a physical machine. And this is the machine. This is not the real thing. Made of wooden tin lids. Okay, it's a mock-up. It was made for the film Enigma. We've got quite a few of them around. And the Germans were very formal with their messages. When you write a letter, well, I don't know about now, but when I was at school, we taught to start off with dear sir or dear madam, and you signed it off yours faithfully. And the germs are still doing that. They are addressing the message to head of whatever, not necessarily General Guderian, but head of that, whatever he may be, wherever he may be. And they are signing the messages off at the beginning of the war, at least for the first year, with the two words, Heil Hitler. Now that puts two H's in two given spots every time at the end of a message. A mistake, a human error, that lets down quite a good machine. Shouldn't do it, but they do.
Right, it's this machine. It was developed and used by Hitler and his generals. So the high command are talking to each other, and the messages that they're generating are absolutely vital to the Allies. There's a lot of very useful information if it's generals talking to generals. Okay? Now the machine has 12 pinwheels, and the wheels are set for every single message. The very first message that helped us to break these Lorenz messages was intercepted at Knockholt in Kent on an intercept station. They intercepted the message. It was about 5,000 characters long, so a very long message. And then shortly afterwards came another message that they thought, well, that's funny. It looks the same, but it's not the same, but it's sort of the same. There's something special about this. Send it to Bletchley Park. Colonel John Tiltman, head codebreaker, sat down with a pencil and paper, and in 10 days he broke that message. What made it easy for him, when they send each of the messages, they have to send to the other end all the wheel settings. And then he started by saying the words Spruch Nummer, message number. And then he sent the message, the 5,000 characters. Now for some reason at the other end, something went wrong because they sent back, sorry, didn't quite get that, please send again. So, being a bit fed up, and I suppose maybe a bit lazy, he set his wheels to the same start positions for the second message he was going to send as he had for the first message. The next thing he did was to send the word Spruch Nummer, but he abbreviated the word number. We abbreviate it to NO, don't we? He abbreviated it to NR because that's a German abbreviation. And then as he's typing the rest of the message, there were lots of other words he could abbreviate. And so he did. So the second message that was intercepted at Knockholt was somewhere around 500 characters shorter than the first. But it said the same thing. And because he set the wheels at the same start position for both messages, they turned in the same pattern for both messages. This was why it looked so different, the same, something wrong at Knockholt. Colonel Tiltman broke the message. He showed his colleague Bill Tupp what he'd done. Bill said, can I borrow it? He's a scientist and a mathematician. He goes away to his team, and 3 weeks later he comes back. I don't know who makes it, he says. And I don't know what it looks like, but I know exactly how it works. He'd worked out the patterns of all those 12 wheels, how they turn in relation to each other to generate those two messages that Colonel Tiltman had managed to break.
80% of those who worked in the huts at Bletchley Park were women. Many were ATS or Wrens. Many were still civilians. Cartoons of them, drawn at that time, still hang on the hut walls. It was through their tired but tireless efforts, inspired by men like Alan Turing, that Bletchley Park was so successful. Shakespeare's words, written so many years ago about the interception of wicked plans, came true again in the 20th century in Bletchley Park.